Grace and mercy and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This whole Holy Week, I've been asking just one question during the sermons and looking at the answer day by day, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and now Easter Sunday, asking the question, what was God doing? On that first Easter Sunday morning, what was God doing as we read it in our text? And I'll tell you, you've got an invested interest in knowing the answer to that question because it's why you're here this morning. Whether somebody else dragged you out of bed or you dragged yourself out of bed and came, the reason that we're here is because of the answer to the question of what Jesus was doing on that first Easter Sunday morning. So let's take a look at that. The first answer to the question, what was God doing on that first Easter Sunday morning, is also the one that gets repeated most often throughout the course of our worship. What he was doing was conquering death. That's the message in Luke. They were just called men. In the other Gospels, it's made clear that these men in their shining clothes are actually angels that appeared to the women who went to the tomb early that first Easter Sunday morning. The men said to the women, in the second half of verse 5 and into verse 6, he said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen." To make sense of that statement, we have to remember what happened just a few days earlier, on Friday, when Jesus was crucified and put to death, and before sundown was quickly buried in the tomb. Why did he do that? He did that because the penalty for all sin is death. But God loved the world, loved you, and loved me so much that he became human so he could take our human sins upon his own flesh and die in our place and be buried under the weight of those sins. And even more than that, yesterday, Holy Saturday, is the day that we remember that he even went down into hell to preach his victory to those who had already died. Jesus endured literally every last ounce of difficulty and hardship and suffering for you and for me, and then rose again, because the very first thing he was accomplishing on that first Easter Sunday morning was that he was conquering death. He was conquering his own death. He had seen death through all the way to the very end, and he was conquering death for all who believe in him, for all who call on his name. Now, focusing on death on Easter Sunday seems a little bit weird to me, a little bit jarring, because we've got all the beautiful flowers, and we've got an Easter egg hunt later, and an Easter breakfast, and everybody's in their Easter finest, and you look fantastic. It's kind of hard under those circumstances. At least, I think people fall into one of two camps. For some of you, death is kind of the furthest thing from your mind when you're in the midst of all this wonderful celebration. For others of you, well, people you love have died, and at every celebration, you remember in some way, in some part of you, the reality and difficulty of death. Whichever camp you're in this morning, the truth remains and is for you and should be spoken into your heart and to your life that our Lord, our risen Lord, has conquered death. He didn't avoid it. He met it head on with arms literally outstretched. And it was spent to the last. And even after death had nothing more to throw at him, he rose again. It could not conquer him. One of the things, and here's another case where I think that children are sometimes a little bit sharper than we are as adults. One of the things that we learn very early on is that things die. We all as children learn that plants die, animals die, humans die. The reality of this life we know is that it will end. But in Christ, we also then know that life can conquer death, because that's what he was doing. It is the first and primary task that he was accomplishing that first Easter morning. He was rising again, triumphant over the grave, proclaiming that he is victorious even over death itself. But here's the funny thing. I am willing to bet my favorite Easter egg that you came through those doors already knowing him. that this is probably, in all likelihood, not some earth-shattering news to you, something you did not expect to hear this Easter morning. And yet, we have to admit, if we're honest, that some part of us, on an impulsive, visceral, core level, still fears death. When Jesus conquered death, death really was, as Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians, the last, the final enemy to be destroyed. And yet, we who must live under its shadow, in bodies that are still stained and struggling with sin, have to admit that death still holds a great deal of fear for us. Maybe not as much for us personally, but as soon as we start to think about it in regards to those that we love, it's not an easy topic, is it? Jesus was conquering death, and for that we thank God and we praise him, not just Easter Sunday, but every single Sunday, as I said to the children. But when he had conquered death, there were still some more foes that he needed to conquer. Not for his sake, but for yours and for mine. For instance, did you notice in the text, the women came. They found the tomb empty. Jesus had already promised them that all of this would happen, and yet, how does verse 5 start? They were frightened. Jesus had already conquered death, and yet fear was still part of their reality. And so we hear the words of the angels, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here, but has risen." In some of the other gospel accounts, they make it plain, "Fear not." Now, we spend most of life, like I said, aware of death and fearing it. But Jesus has not only conquered sin and death, but he also, by his message, has come and conquers fear. Because what sits on the other side of death? Well, that's why death frightens us so. Everything we've experienced is life. Death is the other side of that coin. We've never seen the other side of that coin, have we? Well, we have if you listened to the Isaiah prophecy. In verse 17, he says, "Behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former things shall not be remembered or come to mind." Skipping a few verses, he promises that for us, even after death, no more shall be heard in my new Jerusalem the sound of weeping or the cry of distress. He promises that in that day, before we call, he will answer. That the wolf and the lamb will graze together, and the lion, instead of eating us, will eat straw like the ox, and dust shall be the serpent's food, that they shall not hurt or destroy in all his holy mountain. The reality is, if God can conquer sin, if God can conquer even death itself, then God can conquer anything. We truly have nothing to fear. It doesn't mean we won't wrestle with fear from time to time as part of our human experience, but we know that these promises are true. And so on that first Easter morning, not only was Jesus conquering death itself, but perhaps even more helpful for us in our immediate experiences, he was also conquering fear. He was promising a future far better than anything we've ever asked for, anything that we've ever imagined. He was promising all of our greatest dreams and more. Now, I can understand if you hear those words and your response is to get a little bit skeptical. Frankly, the idea that we serve a God who simply by believing in him, he can conquer death itself and conquer fear so that we can live lives eternally free from fear, that sounds like an offer that's too good to be true. And we're taught from the time that we're quite young, in fact, Christy and I have a 10-year-old, we're trying to help teach him when he sees the advertisements in the store. If it sounds too good to be true, how's that sentence end? It probably is, right? And this sounds too good to be true. The idea that just believing in him can bring forgiveness of sins, the idea that just believing in him means that we've conquered death, means that we conquer fear, that sounds too good to be true, doesn't it? And it's why, even though statistically, this is the Sunday during which the pews in all of the churches in America will be more full than any other Sunday, the fact remains there will be more people out of pews during this day than there will be people in them. Why is that? Well, it's for the same reason you would expect When the women left the tomb, they had seen for themselves the empty tomb. They had heard the angel proclaim that Jesus was living, that they were not to fear anymore. You would expect that when they went to his apostles, people to whom, remember, he had promised all of these things would take place, you would expect that those women would come into that room where those men had been gathered in fear, and they would burst open the doors and say, "Guess what? The tomb is empty. We saw angels. They proclaimed to us that Jesus is risen. He is no longer dead." Now, you would expect at that moment a tremendous party would start. You would expect that those women would be greeted with great joy. They'd be lifted up on their shoulders. They'd be dancing around in the room, right? Is that what happened? When the women came with the news that their Lord and Savior, who had promised that he would rise again from the dead, had indeed risen again from the dead, is that what we read their response was? Nope. Instead, we read in verses 10 and following, it tells us the names of who they were. And it says, the women told these things to the apostles, but these words seemed to the apostles an idle tale, and they did not believe them. What? The news that their Lord had risen from the tomb, that he was alive again and had conquered sin and death and fear, and they were still unmoved? Yep. Because there was another foe that Jesus had to conquer that first Easter morning, that he still comes to conquer, because we wrestle with it even ourselves. He was conquering also doubt. Some people think that to be a person of faith means that you never doubt in your Lord and Savior or any of the teachings in the Bible or any of the teachings of the church. If that is so, I'm disqualified. And if that is so, you're probably disqualified too, at least if you're paying attention. Because I would argue that every one of you, at some point, if you're reading Scripture, if you're studying it, you're going to come to a moment of doubt. You're going to wonder, is this whole thing really true? Is God really going to deliver me? Can he really deliver me from death and from fear? There are going to be times that you're really going to wonder that. That the walls are going to close in around you. That life is going to get difficult. And that we're going to wrestle with doubt. In fact, Dr. Luther, someone that in a Lutheran church we're most of the time rather fond of, he had a great German word for this. I don't know if you speak German. His word was Anfechtungen. You have to love German. Anfechtungen. You almost don't have to speak German to know what it means. It means basically bad times. It means the pressure of doubt and of this world. The way that it's expressed in one of my favorite hymns is that it's fightings and fears within and without. The reality that we are beset by our own sinful nature and a sinful world and a devil that longs to tempt us and torment us. Anfechtungen. Luther didn't say that belief in Christ was the way that we escape Anfechtungen, the way that we escape these difficulties and these doubts. In fact, he said the opposite. These difficulties and doubts that we face in our lives, brought on by things like fear, brought on by things like death, are the proving ground of our faith. By which I mean not that you're put to the test so that you can show your faith, but they are the place where your faith shows itself most brightly, where your Lord proves himself most brilliantly and gloriously. Jesus rose again that first Easter morning to conquer death, but even after he had done so, the women and the disciples were still afraid. And so he rose again that first Easter morning so that he could conquer also fear. And even after he had proclaimed these things, things that had been promised for centuries, he still had another foe to conquer, one he still does battle with to this day. He was conquering doubt. Did you know that Easter is not just a day? That technically Easter lasts 7 weeks? We're actually going to take advantage of that. We do every year within the church. We're going to celebrate. Next week's going to be the second Sunday of Easter, and then the third Sunday of Easter. I'm sure you're getting the pattern, right? Right on through the seventh Sunday of Easter. We're going to celebrate for 7 weeks that our Lord is risen, because he continued to show himself to his apostles and to those around to prove that he was who he said he was, that he had done what he had promised he would do, that he was risen. He's risen indeed. Hallelujah. What does that mean? Risen indeed. Well, indeed. in action, in what actually happened. We had the joy in our adult study the last few weeks to look at all of the historical and archaeological evidence surrounding the empty tomb. And I can say with absolute confidence, we have more evidence for an empty tomb than we have for any other event in ancient history, period. If you want to reject the story of the empty tomb, you can go right ahead, but you're going to have to reject the rest of ancient history too. And so we have the empty tomb. He is risen indeed, in action, in fact. He has risen. But there's another thing that indeed can mean. It can mean truly. It can mean actually. It can mean the sort of fact that actually affects your life even now. And that's the joy and truth of what we proclaim this Easter morning. Not that some wandering prophet rose from the dead 2,000 years ago, but that wandering prophet was in fact the Son of God who had been born and lived and died and rose again for you and for me and for all sinners everywhere. And that first Easter morning is the same thing. What God was doing that first Easter morning was the same thing he's doing this Easter morning. And every morning, he was rising again to conquer death, which has no power over you or anyone who calls on Jesus' name. He was rising again to conquer the fears that we still have to wrestle with even after we know that truth. And he was rising again to conquer and continue to conquer the doubts, the anfechtungen, that we have to face in the ins and outs of life here on this earth. He was rising again so that you could know for certain that you will rise again. He was rising again to conquer, not just for himself, but for you and for all who believe, all who call on his name, to conquer death, to conquer fear, and to conquer doubt. So that not just with our mouths on Easter morning, but with our mouths and with our minds and with our hearts and with our actions, every single aspect of our lives would proclaim with joy and certainty, whether there's a smile on our face or tears running down our cheeks, we could proclaim and know it to be true. You get a chance to say it with me again. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
And may our Lord and Savior guard your hearts and minds firmly in this truth, in Jesus Christ. Amen. And I invite you.